Very warm good morning to all of you. Welcome to this webinar series. This is the fourth lecture we have in the series on configuring the region, configuring the vernacular regions, historical perspectives. We are privileged to have Dr. Manu Devadevan today. Dr. Pathy, I'm going ahead. Okay.
Yes.
Today we are very privileged to have Dr. Manu Devadevan, a distinguished scholar on South Asian studies. The last three lectures, we have our Honorable Vice Chancellor, distinguished participant, which include Professor Patitababan Mishra, Dr. Nivedita Mahanti, and many others from different parts of the country. A very warm welcome again. And we had three lectures which cautioned us against our modern dispositions. Our modern dispositions to consider region with boundness, homogeneity, coherence, stability, and structure. Social reality, as they cautioned us, by Professor Sahu, Professor Bishnu Mahapatra, as well as Professor Chandi Prasad Nanda, they made us rather plead much, saying that social reality is much more complex and characterized by variability, inconsistency, change, and conflict. Vernacularization of second millennium totally created a textual, cultural, geospatial space called Uttaradesha in Odishan context, but in other contexts, as in the case of Prophet Dr. Devadevan's work on Kannada. But in the configuration of this vernacular world, it also involves social dissent against Brahminical orthodox. Vernacular literary text of medieval India open up new historical archives and suggest provoking perspectives on past when they are read as discursive text. Thus, reading would help us understand the contesting values, ordering a worldview or worldviews which questions the hegemonic narrative. Morphology of dissent, when mapped within the literary traditions of Odisha from the days of Sudramani Saraladas, who wrote Odia Mahabharata in 15th century AD, reveals new templates of social and economic ordering that not only questions the Brahmanical centering, but also advocate alternative ordering based on equality and universality. Lakshmi Purana by Balarama, thus, according to Professor Satya Mahanti, articulates values of self-critical individuality, challenge the dominant social structure and its patriarchal and caste-based value system. According to Mahanti, Professor Mahanti of Cornell University, a feminist and anti-caste critic of patriarchal behavior can be seen in Lakshmi Purana. To talk about Lakshmi Purana and understanding the process of vernacularizations, we have today an eminent scholar, Dr. Manu Devadevan. If second millennium walls were expressed to vernacular text, Dr. Manu Devadevan is perhaps the most apt scholar in India. He is a polyglot, and his knowledge of Sanskrit, Odia, his mother tongue, Kannada, Tamil, Malayali, made him the scholar in India to make us understand this process of vernacularization. If, according to Sheldon Pollack, Kannada was the model of vernacular region of pre-colonial, Manu Devadevan is the scholar to listen to. His two books, Prehistory of Hinduism, published by De Gruyter in 2016, and Early Medieval Origin of India, are provocative. And these two highly acclaimed books, apart from many articles such as been published in JSO, were noticed and recognized by scholarly world today. Infosys conferred him with a laureate in humanities and social sciences for the year 2019. I must state that with certain degree of trepidation as well, that the manuscript of prehistory was completed in Bhubaneswar, where Devadevan worked in an educational institute almost incognito in Odisha. About prehistory of Hinduism, Sheldon Pollock writes, unlike most other analysts, Manu Devadevan can actually read pre-colonial text, in this case, the very rich archives of Kannada material, and thereby make real sense of economic, social, and conceptual changes that, with ever-accelerating speed in the early modern period, produced new category thinking about religion. This new category is based in Devadevan's analysis, advance on an unprecedented development economies, you know, the rupture that colonialism brought about. Hinduism as a religious community, at least in one South Asia region, was an outcome of 19th century, as you know, one of my close mentors, Staten Crown, used to write an invented traditions. Welcome, Professor Dr. Manu Devadevan, who teaches in the Humanities and Social Science Center of IIT Mandi. His talk is titled as Lakshmi Purana of Balarama Dasa, Some Reflection on Alienation. Is it an alienation from production system, which obviously continues, or a cultural alienation will be dealt by Dr. Manu Devadevan? I am very privileged to welcome you, sir. I am also equally privileged to welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Register, Deputy Register, and many other participants who are here, including many of our students from across different states. Welcome, and now I request Honorable Vice Chancellor to give a welcome note. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Mishra. I think, first of all, Dr. Manu Devadevan is around?
Sir.
Okay. Welcome, Dr. Manu Devadevan. Nice to see you, the intellectual inheritance of Professor Anantamurthy. Okay, and I'm very glad that you have agreed to...
Your voice is breaking, sir.
Yeah, you have agreed to talk on the Lakshmi Purana, which holds a very significant place in the history of Odia literature, about which I think Dr. Mishra has highlighted just now. Very interestingly, about this, I think S.P. Mahanty had also written, and Dr. Manu Devadevan, I am sure you must have been aware of Professor Mahanty's on colonialism and literature, which was dedicated to Professor U.R. Anantamurthy, who is supposed to have inspired that book. It's about mostly what is interesting is a scholar who is from Kannada literary tradition is speaking on Lakshmi Purana. I think that is very, very interesting. Not just interesting, it is an intellectual endeavor worth appreciating and even emulating. Well, Lakshmi Purana is considered from various angles, but here I think Dr. Manu Devadevan is going to reflect on the alienation apart from the, you know, indigenous modernity that S.P. Mahanty talks about. I'm sure this lecture will be very, very interesting, and I look forward to this lecture just like many of you. Welcome again, Dr. Manu Devadevan. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now I invite Dr. Manu Devadevan to deliver his lecture.
Good morning. Am I audible? Can you all hear me?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Nagaraju. It's a great honor to be with you today. A great honor to be sharing a set of thoughts concerning a text with a group of people who know the text more intimately than I do. And thank you, Dr. Umakant Mishra, for making this lecture possible. It was so generous of you to have urged me to speak today. I have visited Sambalpur several times, but I've never been to your university. I wish I was physically present there today. It's wonderful to see that your institution is named after one of the greatest literary figures in the history of Odisha, Gangadhar Mehr, who's fondly remembered as a Swabhavakavi. He's the author of such masterpieces as Tapaswini, which is one of my favorite poems, Padmini, Rasaratnakara, Kavita Kallola, Indumati, Utkalalakmi, Pranaya Ballari. I learned that Gangadhar Mehr's interest in literature began when, as a young boy, he heard the recitation of Balarama Das's Jagamohana Ramayana, which is a monumental work in Odia, as great as the Sharada Bharata and Jagannatha Das's Bhagavata. I have been thinking of writing something on the Jagamohana Ramayana, but every time I sit down to write, I get the sense that I'm still not ready for it. The Jagamohana Ramayana is a popular text. At least it used to be popular in Odisha until 5 or 6 decades ago. But another text of Balarama Das's might certainly score over the Jagamohana Ramayana in terms of popular appeal. And this is the Lakshmi Purana. And this is the text which I'm going to talk about today. There is a body of writings in Odia on the Panchasakas and the Lakshmi Purana, but not much is found in English. So those of you who are interested in the historical context must consult the works of Basant Kumar Malik. And on the Lakshmi Purana per se, there is an insightful paper which both Dr. Nagaraju and Dr. Mishra referred to. This paper is by Satyaprakash Mahanti. It's called Alternative Modernities and Medieval Indian Literature. Mahanti tries to place the text within the debate on alternative sources of modernity, which is a line of thinking that I am deeply interested in. Malik, on the other hand, goes to the extent of arguing that what we see in the works of the Panchasakas is modernity itself. My approach to the text is somewhat different, but eventually, in some senses, it dovetails with Mahanti's arguments, although I might not agree with him on one count, which is the argument that the Lakshmi Purana is a feminist text. I'm sorry, I had no access to a critical edition of the text when I worked on it. There were no critical editions available. I had to rely on the text in Raghunatha Rao's book, Manavasa Lakshmi Purana Katha, published from Cuttack in 2006. And I compared this text with the one that I found in a chapbook edition, that I bought in Puri in 2011. So I learned that there is a critical edition available now, which seems to be a slightly longer version than the popular version. It is edited by Gauranga Das. It was published only last year, and Umakant Babu tells me that it is an outstanding edition. But I'm not surprised. If Gauranga Das is editing a text, it has to be outstanding. Thank you. It's not available with any online bookseller, so I have to travel to Bhubaneswar to get a copy, and for that, I have to wait for the pandemic to come to an end. So I wish the book was published a couple of years ago, because until the end of 2019, that is just before the pandemic, I visited Bhubaneswar every month. But never mind, I'll grab a copy very soon. So for today's lecture, I'm using Raghunath Rao's text and the chapbook text that I mentioned, and an English translation done by my dear friend, Manorama Tripathi, who's a reluctant academic, who has been working on a doctoral dissertation for the last 13 years. 13 varshas arigilleni thanka PhD complete hai ni. She's also a reluctant writer who occasionally publishes stories and essays in places such as Dharitri and Katha, who has about half a dozen brilliant stories, short stories, that she is yet to send to a publisher. And for nearly 10 years, she has been working on a novel with an amazing story, a story that will be of interest to historians. She has a manuscript of about 200 pages, but she's yet to complete it. So I asked her to join me in a research project on the literary history of 16th century South Asia. And as part of it, as part of this project, I urged her to translate the Lakshmi Purana into English, which she of course kept postponing for a while. And then during one of my monthly visits to Bhubaneswar in 2016, I took a few days off and made her sit in front of me to do the translation. And I must tell you, we did this in some exquisite locations. Ame arambha karithilu kendoli re, Jayadevankara janmasthana re. On the second day, ame vasithilu Ramachandi re, Srimandira jayithilu. दर्शन करके हमें रामचंडी पढ़े लो सिटी समुद्र कोड़ रे बसी की ट्रांसलेट करो तापरे हीरापुर रे चौसठ जोगिनी मंदिर रे तापरे खंडगिरी रे रानी गुम्फा रे एंड ऑन द लास्ट डे हमें भुवनेश्वर रे महाबोधि सोसाइटी रे गोटे ब्रांच अच्छे सिटी हमें बोधि वृक्ष तले बसी की ट्रांसलेट करो 3-4 आवर्स एवरी डे त्रिपाठी मैडम गोटे गोटे लाइन पढ़ी की बुझाइले ट्रांसलेट करले बेले-बेले corrections suggest करली, so that's how the Lakshmi Purana was translated. So it's published in a book, Cleo and Her Descendants, which is the Keshavan Veluttat Felicitation volume that I edited. I'm sorry, I think I've been supplying too many bits of autobiographical information. Let me come to the subject. The 16th century is known for the efflorescence of Vaishnava bhakti in various parts of India. It already begins in the 15th century on a small scale, on a modest scale. And we have some of the best known figures in India's religious history from this period, the 15th and 16th century. Eknath in Maharashtra, Annamaya in Andhra, the Haridasas in Karnataka, that is Purandara Dasa, Kanaka Dasa and others. Eluthachan, Charasheri, Melpathur and Pundanam in Kerala, Shankar Dev in Assam, Narsi Mehta in Gujarat, known for his famous poem, Vaishnava Janato Dehe Kahiye, Peer Paraye Jane Re, Meera in Rajasthan, Chaitanya in Bengal, Kabir, Surdas, Tulsidas and Raskan in Uttar Pradesh, Keshavdas in Madhya Pradesh. You can see that it's simply phenomenal. So this trend, this trend that we see across much of India in the 16th century is represented in Odisha by the Panchasakhas. Balarama Dasa, Jagannatha Dasa, Achyutananda Dasa, Yashwanta Dasa and Shishu Ananta Dasa. The coastal town of Puri was the heart or nerve center of Vaishnava Bhakti in Odisha. So we learned that Chaitanya lived in Puri for more than 20 years. And was successful in earning the Suryavamshi king Pratapa Rudra's patronage. He had two companions in Puri, Swarupa Damodara and Ramananda Rai. The Panchasakas were his contemporaries. Not merely contemporaries, they were thick friends sharing common interests. In fact, historians consider this period as being a Panchasaka phase in Odisha history. The period that begins with the Suryavamshi ruler Purushottama is rich in legends, rich in folklore. Of course, there are legends from a slightly earlier period itself, from the days of the last Ganga ruler Bhanudeva IV. The Panchasaka period is particularly rich in stories concerning the lives of the saints. So the word Panchasaka itself might be as old as the 16th century. We have the use of this expression, for instance, in Achyutananda Das's Shunya Sangeeta. So there we are told that on one occasion, the five saints who were friends were dancing in the company of Chaitanya. And they were doing this in the presence of Pratapa Rudra. Chitananda Dasa Kahanti, Ananta Achyuta Geni Jashabanta Balarama Jagannatha E Pancha Sakahi Nrutyakari Hele Gauranga Chandra Sangata. Ujiliki. E Pancha Sakahi Nrutyakari Hele Gauranga Chandra Sangata. So it's not unlikely that Chaitanya formed a kind of link between the Panchasakas and the Krishna Bhakti saints from other parts of India. Chaitanya traveled widely. He is said to have been in Vrindavan for a while. Even so, there is no need to posit that the 16th century devotionalism that we see in Puri was brought from elsewhere. Because there were antecedent developments within Odisha from the 15th century. We know of Markanda Dasa, who wrote the Keshava Koili. There was Arjuna Dasa, who wrote the Ramabibha, and another text called Kalpalata, which I'm afraid I've not seen. And of course, there was the redoubtable Sarala Dasa, known for his Mahabharata, Bilanka Ramayana, and Chandi Purana. So Balarama Dasa was a rebellious saint, but Sarala was many times more rebellious than Balarama. And he was a master of innovations as well. At one place, he tells us that Draupadi was secretly in love with Karna, a one-sided love. And then he says that the famous banyan tree, Vatavruksha, with which the image of Jagannatha was originally carved, was actually the body of Krishna, the fossilized body of Krishna, which was cast into the sea at Dwarka and which reached Puri floating on the sea. And so far as I can tell, Sarala was the first to propose that Jagannatha was an embodiment of void, Shunya Purusha, and that he was actually the Buddha. He says in the Mahabharata, Mahodadi tire bada devulare basi daridra mananko dukkha devucha dvansi. Buddha rupare kali yuge avatara. Buddha rupare kali yuge avatara hoyena papi jananko karucha uddhara. These lines are from the Madhya Parva. Sabha Parva re Sarala Dasa Kahanti samsara janaku tariba nimante buddha rupe hoi accha jagannathe. So Balarama Dasa and the other Panchasakas were producing their work in the immediate aftermath of these developments. I also want to invite your attention to a specific context that made the works of the Panchasakas significant. So here I am drawing upon two fascinating papers that Gaganendranath Das wrote more than four decades ago. It appeared in the famous volume that Anne Charlotte Deshman, Gayacharan Tripathi and Herman Kulke edited, The Cult of Jagannath and the Regional Tradition of Odisha. So these papers are on the growth of power among the priests in the Jagannatha temple. So one is for the earlier period, the Ganga period. The second paper is on the Suryavamshi period. The priests begin to consolidate their hold on the temple from the 13th century onwards. And by the time we are in the later half of the 15th century, there is more or less a competition between the state, the Suryavamshi Gajapati state, and the priests, as far as affairs related to the Puri temple are concerned. We don't know if Anantavarman Chodaganga, who built the temple in the 12th century, we don't know if he made any land grants to the temple. We have no records to this effect. He made grants to the temple, but these were not land grants. Ananga Bhima III might be the first ruler to make land grants to the temple. That brings us to the 13th century. So land endowment enables Srimandira to become a major landed magnate. Its land holdings begins to swell over time, which might be one of the sources of the influence that the priests wielded. So after Narasimha I, he's the son of Ananga Bhima III and he's the famous builder of the Sun Temple in Konark in the 13th century. So after his rule, we find that the Ganga rulers are not as triumphant on the war front as Narasimha the First himself, or Ananga Bhima the Third, or Chodaganga. Many of them face military reverses. There is an invasion by Firuz Shah Tughlaq, and this state of affairs continues for nearly a century and a half. That's enough time for the priests to establish their influence. So Bhanu Deva the Fourth was the last Ganga ruler, and from what little we know of him, he was fairly successful on the battlefield. There is an impression that Bhanu Deva the Fourth was a disastrous ruler, and we don't get a credible picture of Bhanu Deva in most writings. K.C. Panigrahi is somewhat charitable to him, but N. Venkata Ramanaya is actually not. But I am of the view that Bhanu Deva the Fourth was quite a formidable ruler. Besides, the legend about his involvement in the Puri temple also indicates that he was perhaps a hard nut to crack. That's obviously reason enough for friction, you see. The Madala Panji calls him mad, Matta Bhanu. So during one of his campaigns in Andhra, Kapilendra usurps the throne in 1435, and in the legends from Puri, we get the impression that the Puri priests came out actively in support of Kapilendra. This is not the end of the story. The priests were apparently favorable towards Kapilendra, but they had a hard time handling his son, Purushottama, the hero of the Kanchi Kaveri story. He changes the rituals in the temple, introduces procedures such as, what was the procedure that he introduced? I forget. I think Gopal Archana Vidhi, he introduces that procedure for worship. Composes a Gita Govinda of his own, imitating Jayadeva's work, and makes its performance a part of the temple ritual. So he assumes the role of the first servant of Jagannatha, the Adya Sevaka, which technically speaking makes him the senior most priest, one step above the Bhidharija Mahapatra. Of course, we don't really know that if there was a Bhidharija Mahapatra or a Talija Mahapatra in Purushottama's times. I believe these were offices that came into existence after the restoration of the temple in 1591-92 by the Khurda ruler, Ramachandra, famous as the second Indradyumna, Dvitiya Indradyumna. And Purushottama introduces ceremonies such as the Cherabhara, which is sweeping the chariot during the annual Rath Yatra. So Raja Purushottama is a servant of the god. He's a servant of the god, but he's also god. We have this contradicting image there. He's Adya Sevaka, but he's also a living or walking Vishnu, Chalanti Vishnu. His son, Prataparudra, was even more powerful. He came into conflict with the Vijayanagara king, Krishna Devaraya. But he put up such a strong front that by the time Krishna Devaraya captured the fort of Udayagiri in Andhra, he had more or less exhausted himself. And he began to celebrate the capture of Udayagiri in his inscriptions with words that create the impression that this little known fort in Andhra was the center of the universe. And Krishna Devaraya never managed to capture any region to the north of the river Krishna. In fact, some parts of the areas to the south of Krishna continued to be with Prataparudra. We see him making grants. There after the conflict with Krishna Devaraya. So Krishna Devaraya had no choice left with him but to act like a few rulers from our own times. Living in a world of fairy tales and making the people believe that these fairy tales are true. So he created the fairy tale that he marched up to Cuttack, burnt the city. His inscriptions and Telugu literary works produced in his court, such as the Amukta Malyada and Manu Charitramu. These texts give us the impression, they give a description of the so-called campaign, from which one thing becomes very clear. The men who produced these works had a fairly good idea of the areas to the south of the river Krishna, but they had hardly a clue of the geography of the areas to the north of the river. But unfortunately, historians, even historians in Odisha, believe that this cock and bull story is actually history. Anyway, Prataparudra knew what he was doing, and the priests were obviously not happy about it. That's when Prataparudra starts patronizing Chaitanya, the Panchasakas. He starts patronizing the Vaishnava saints, and in the process, he creates a strong front against the priests. He produces a powerful counterweight to the power of the priests. The saints, be it Chaitanya, Balarama Dasa, Jagannatha Dasa, they turn out to be far more popular among the people than the priests. This is a very interesting case of the state joining hands with the saints to bring the priest to heels. But eventually it is the priests who succeed. They make Prataparudra, Chaitanya, the Panchasakas, all of them part of the temple legends. So before discussing the Lakshmi Purana, let me briefly tell you a few words about the life of Balaramadasa. Balaramadasa was the eldest of the Panchasakas. He was the senior most among them. Very little is known about his life. He was born in Eravanga, that is a village that is some 30 kilometers to the northeast of Puri. We have no means to ascertain the date of his birth. It was sometime between 1470 and 1485. The date that is now widely mentioned is 1472, which is a date that Arthavalla Mahanti had suggested. Balaramadasa's mother was Jamuna Devi. She's also called Mahamaya Devi in some accounts. And his father was Somanatha, who was a functionary under the king, under Prataparudra. He held more than a single position. He was a Patra, he was Mahapatra, he was Mahamantri. This was fairly common, you know. Achyutananda Dasa's father, Dinabandhu, was also in royal service, and he also held many offices. He was Karana, he was Mahanti, Patratile, Kuntiatile. Please don't treat these as names of different castes. That's what they are today. Today they are the names of various castes, but the situation was fairly different in the 16th century. So Somanatha was in state service, and Balaramadasa was also in state service for a while. And he continued to maintain a healthy relationship with Prataparudra even after becoming a saint. In the Bhatta Bhakasha, he says, Balaramadasa pahile visheshi Prataparudra Raja Sunina Prashamsi. Balaramadasa was initiated into the Vishishtadvaita tradition of Ramanuja, and in turn performed the rite of initiation for the fellow saint Jagannatha Dasa, who was a Brahmana by birth. So the act of a Shudra initiating a Brahmana was a defiant challenge to the caste hierarchies, you know, which is likely to have come as a provocation to the orthodoxy of the times. Balaramadasa's rebelliousness didn't go well with the temple priests, who prevailed upon the king to place him under confinement for some time. Balaramadasa seems to have spent the later years of his life as a wandering mendicant. We don't know much about the last days of his life. He produced more than 20 works during his lifetime, including the Lakshmi Purana. He wrote the Jagamohana Ramayana. He also rendered the Bhagavad Gita into Odisha, a fascinating text. And he also wrote a number of other works, Virata Gita, Amarakosha Gita, Gupta Gita, Brahma Gita, Vedanta Sarva Gita, what else? And many other such texts, Baramasa Koyali, Kanta Koyali, Kamala Lochana Chautesha, Hanuman Chautesha, Bhattavakasha itself, Mrigunistuti. The Lakshmi Purana is not a very long text. The text, in its popular version, I have not seen the critical edition, the popular version is about 1,068 lines in length. It is composed in the Dandi meter, which consists of couplets having 14 syllables in each line, with the end syllable of each couplet rhyming. This is my understanding of a Dandi meter. So those who know the language and its literature better than I do believe that Dandi was a fairly flexible meter. Umakant Babu told me about this a couple of months ago. Like most Panchasaka compositions, this work is also written in a colloquial diction. A colloquial diction that is easy for the illiterate masses to commit to memory. It is certainly more quotidian in its concerns than other contemporary works. Baladamadasa produced this work for the women folk of the region, who until the later half of the 20th century were mostly illiterate. They didn't go to school. So women listened to the recitation of the texts and oftentimes seems to have memorized it in full or in parts. This fulfilled a major ritual function, only a major ritual function, because I believe that the pedagogic concerns of the text might have remained a dead letter for most of the text's history in circulation. So until the invasion of the television a few decades ago, mind you, after Buddhism and the Advaita of Shankaracharya, television is the greatest pedagogic stroke that made the Indian mind sterile. Okay, until the television invaded the Indian homes a few decades ago, it was not uncommon to come across Odia women who could recite the whole of Lakshmi Purana from memory. So this class of women is all too rare today, and I'm of the view that this class might soon be a thing of the past. The Lakshmi Purana is in the form of a story which the sage Parashara tells Narada. On one occasion, Narada and Parashara are wandering in the world. One day they reach a village where they find everyone from Brahmana to Chandala celebrating the festival of Lakshmi. Members of all castes are participating in the festival. There is no sense of discrimination anywhere. They celebrate it with a sense of camaraderie that is hard to miss. So Narada is curious to know what festival it is and how and why it is celebrated. Parashara tells the story. He tells the story behind the festival. So there is an ideational framing of the narrative in these prefatory lines. And I think that Balaramadasa is shying away from stating it in so many words. Narada is the son of Brahma, the creator. Kintu Parashara kiye? Parashara is, according to a widely held belief, a widely popular belief, born of a Chandala woman. The earliest piece of literature where Parashara is mentioned points to his Avarna origins. But later sources refer to it without any sense of ambiguity, so to speak. Of course, they do not identify a Chandala woman as his mother. The Bhavishya Purana, where we come across a critique of Varna classification, a critique that is far more penetrating than the so-called critique that you have in Buddhism. This text, that is the Bhavishya Purana, identifies Parashara as born of a Swapaka woman. In the Dharma Shastras, the Swapaka is the offering, the offspring of a Kshatri father and an Ugra mother. The Kshatri is born of the union of a Shudra father and a Kshatriya mother. And the Ugra is the other way around, from the union of a Kshatriya father and a Shudra mother. So going by the popular legend, the son of a Chandala woman instructing the creator's son is important in political terms for the unrelenting position against caste discrimination that Balaramadasa takes. This is more so because a Chandala woman has a crucial part to play in the text. So here is the story that Parashara tells Narada. So it's a Thursday in the month of Margashira, a day that is auspicious to Lakshmi. The goddess asks her husband Jagannatha to allow her to visit the town to meet her devotees and offer them blessings. Jagannatha agrees but cautions her not to delay the day's food, the preparation of food in the name of a visit to her devotees. The lord of the world, Jagannatha, is quite a foodie, you see, and so is his elder brother, Balarama. Lakshmi takes the form of an old Brahmana woman. She disguises herself and moves from street to street to see how her devotees are observing the festival. But as it turns out, she's not impressed. There are no signs of ceremony anywhere. Women are lazy. They are laid back. They are fast asleep. They are callous. Only a handful of them show a sense of duty and piety. When Lakshmi reaches the door of a seafarer, and ask the lady why she has not observed the Lakshmi Puja. The woman tells her that she is not aware of it. What festival is this? She asks Lakshmi. Tell me of it and I'll observe it if it appears to me. So Lakshmi describes to the seafarer's wife how the festival has to be performed. This is followed by a fairly long discourse on the duties of a pious woman. So this is the most disappointing segment of the text. This part of the text is a piece of, what shall I call it? It's a piece of undiluted patriarchy. I am saying this to the dismay of feminists who have often regarded the Lakshmi Purana as a manifesto for women's liberation. I'm sorry, there is no feminism here. It ties down a woman to the domestic sphere. It turns her into a docile body, that submits to her husband and parents-in-law, never allowing her to speak against them or swerve from obedience to them under any circumstances whatsoever. Let's get back to the text. So after instructing the seafarer's wife, the goddess moves to the street of the Chandalas. So here she meets a woman called Shriya. Please note that Shriya is also one of Lakshmi's many names. This woman has washed herself early in the morning. She has put on clean clothes. Her body and mind are pure. And with this purity, she has performed the worship of Lakshmi along the lines that are laid out. The Chandala woman appears to be an embodiment of devotion, an embodiment of piety, an embodiment of purity. Lakshmi is absolutely pleased. So she accepts Shriya's devotion and showers upon her all wealth and riches. Shriya's hut turns into a palatial mansion. It has pillars and railings that are made of gems and precious stones. The woman, she was childless actually. She is blessed with many children, and her cattle shed is now filled with kind. So now it is time for Lakshmi to return home. In the meantime, Jagannatha and Balarama have gone to the forest. They have gone to the forest for hunting. Balarama is a great yogi, you know. He's a great yogi who can see what others can't. And in his yogic eyes, he has had a glimpse of Lakshmi entering the house of a Chandala woman. So he tells Jagannatha that he cannot allow Lakshmi to return home. She does this every time, he tells Jagannatha. She enters the home, she enters the house of untouchables and gets back to the temple without bathing. She has been polluting us for too long. It cannot be permitted anymore. She has to be driven away. So if you can't drive her away, you may also leave the temple. Balarama kahanti Jagannatha emante hele tame bi Sri Mandir chadi ki jibaku padi. Hela, go to the Chandala street, make a palace for yourself, and live with your wife there. So Jagannatha is in a real fix. He doesn't want to abandon Lakshmi. He cannot disobey his elder brother either. So eventually, he decides to call it quits with his wife. So when Lakshmi at the temple gate, he asks her to leave. Lakshmi is taken aback. There is a heated exchange of words between the couple. Both of them trading a variety of bizarre charges against each other. So Lakshmi discards all of the temple and leaves the palace. So all her attendants follow her. So they reach the seashore. So Lakshmi is what she is, the fickle-minded goddess, homeless, humiliated, all too powerful. So she is keen on vengeance. So she summons Vishwakarma, the architect divine, and gets a palace built for herself on the seashore. She then charges the 8 Vedala vampires to raid the temple at night when the two brothers are asleep. So the vampires carry all the wealth from the treasury. They empty the temple's granary to the last drain. They place the loot at Lakshmi's service and earn a reward, a place for themselves in Vaikuntha. So the brothers wake up in the morning to find that the temple is deserted. There is silence everywhere. There are no attendants, and the temple and the daily bustle that you have in the temple is missing. The brothers are in for a rude shock to find that not only the people, but the great volumes of wealth and grain hoarded in the temple have also disappeared. Balarama and Jagannatha are in a state of utter confusion. More importantly, there is nothing left to eat. They remain hungry for a day, The next day, they can't take the hunger anymore. So they disguise themselves as the Brahmana beggars and wander through the town. But they don't find food. You know? They're not able to find food. At one place, people drive them away, charging them of being thieves. At another place, when a family offers them food, Lakshmi makes the food vanish miraculously. Elsewhere, when they are offered the popped rice, Lakshmi summons the wind god and has the food blown away. And when they go to a pond, the goddess sees to it that the water has disappeared. Hungry, thirsty, tired, the brothers learn from a mendicant that a woman living in a palace on the seashore offers food to anyone who visits her. So when they set out for the seashore, Lakshmi urges the sun to heat up the sand to such an extent that the brothers cannot walk. So there is much drama at Lakshmi's house when the brothers reach there braving the burning sand. Lakshmi informs Balarama and Jagannath through her maid servants that she is willing to offer them food, but that she is a Chandala woman, and accepting food from her will make them lose their caste. We'll cook for ourselves, Balarama tells the maid servants. Give us a new pot and some food stuff. So Lakshmi asks the maid servants to give the brothers all they need. And then she charges the fire god that the fire kindled by the brothers should generate no heat. So the brothers' attempt to cook is a failure. So in the end, Balarama concedes a defeat and agrees to accept food from the Chandala woman, the food that the Chandala woman has cooked. Lakshmi cooks a sumptuous meal for the brothers. The brothers bathe and are served the meal, which is so delicious, it reminds them of Lakshmi. So it is now revealed that the Chandala woman is none other than Lakshmi herself. Balarama requests Jagannath to see her back to the temple. And Jagannatha pleads before his wife to return. So Lakshmi has been actually waiting for the Tsar. She's only eager to return to her husband, but she won't give in so easily. I'll come back, she tells him, but only if you accept my terms. Everyone from Chandala to Brahmana shall feed each other and each together from the same pot in the temple. If you agree to this, I'm coming with you. Jagannath agrees and Lakshmi returns to the temple. So this is the story. The Lakshmi Purana tells us of a time when lower castes were not allowed entry into the Jagannatha temple. Now, did this change in the 16th century after Balarama Das's powerful critique of caste discrimination? We actually don't know. If it did change, the change did not last for long. We have testimony from the colonial archives, which Ishita Banerjee Dubey has mentioned in a book. We have testimony to the effect that as many as 19 groups were not allowed into the temple in the early 19th century because they were polluted. And if things in the temple didn't really change in the 16th century, the critique was certainly not made in vain. The Lakshmi Purana turned out to be one of the best cloud texts ever written in Odia. So a bitterly comic piece of criticism of a mighty lord became a part of the region's ritual life. That in itself is pretty fascinating. So the critique of caste that we see in the Lakshmi Purana is of considerable interest because it does not call for a rejection of caste per se. Nor do we see here a mere plea for equality or a critique of caste hierarchies and Brahmin supremacy. What we see here instead is a conscious assertion of caste identity, which in this case pertains to the Chandala caste, and a demand for recognition of this identity with dignity. In this sense, it is not the disavowal of caste that we see in the text, but a call for equality. A call for equality that accepts diversity without invoking or justifying hierarchy and exclusion. That is what is fascinating about this text. Balarama Das's call for equality is of a very different order when compared to earlier campaigns against caste and Varna systems in India. So 2000 years before Balarama Das, the Buddha
had questioned Brahmana claims to superiority, but what his work in effect involved was the creation of a Sangha, a coterie that eventually developed into an organized monastic faith. You know, so you move away from the existing system and create your own system. And in the 12th century, Basava and his contemporaries had identified a class of Shaivite saints as Sharanas, which was not a monastic order like the Buddha's Sangha, but arose nevertheless to generate sectarian groups of their own that are now identified as followers of Virashaivism. So in both instances, with Basava as well as with the Buddha, groups that swerve by egalitarian ideals were created, new groups were created with their own norms of inclusion and exclusion, although for very different historical reasons and under very, very widely varying historical contexts. Balaramadasa was in contrast representing humankind with a broader understanding of equality that did not set out to create a different groups, no. He did not want to create a distinct group, but opened up a field where everyone had an equal presence with no group having exclusive claims over it. The process of othering that we see here is absolute and is not flexible or reversible as it used to be in earlier times. So the Chandala shall remain a Chandala and assert his identity without taking on another egalitarian identity, another identity of an egalitarian character, you know, either by relinquishing the existing identity as was the case with the Buddhist Sangha, or by retaining it as was the case of several of Basava's contemporaries in the 12th century. So the othering that we see here in Balaramadasa is, I want to argue, the product of historical developments involving the advent of a historical phase of alienation by the 16th century. It is necessary to shed some light on the manner in which things were organized before the 16th century if we are to get a finer sense of alienation that made its presence felt in the days of Balaramadasa. I'm afraid I have to be very brief here because the whole idea is rather complex. This order of things reaches back to the 5th century. Bharavi's Kiratarjuniya is one of the earliest texts in which this finds expression. I have elsewhere argued that there is in Bharavi's poem, there is in the Kiratarjuniya, a new way of configuring the relationship between the subject and the object. The subject is the person who looks at the world, and the object is what appears to him or her. So in his work, Bharavi chooses to represent the ideal of valor, Veerarasa, the ideal of valor that his hero Arjuna embodied. So this is done through a method of crafting the text in which the poet uses the ideal of valor as the tool to achieve his ends. Put in simple words, Bharavi is looking at valor through the looking glass of valor. There is no difference here between the object of representation and the categories through which it is represented. They are one and the same. What it means functionally is that the message and the medium are now conflated. In cognitive terms, this means something else. This means that there is a conflation of the subject and the object. So the subject is gazing at the object, but insofar as the two are conflated, it is verily the subject that the subject is gazing at. So this is the cognitive structure that we come across in literatures produced after Bharavi. Although it is not valor that is represented all the time, the objects of representation varied from desire, shringara, to devotion, bhakti. But the representation necessarily happened through categories that were the same as the object being represented. This relationship between the subject and the object did not come to an end. They did not cease to exist in the 16th century. But at the same time, a new trend, a parallel trend, arose in this period that is indicative of alienation. So what is characteristic of this phase of development was a profound shift in consciousness that involved at the object, that which looked at the object through a different lens. You know, it looked at the object not through itself, but looked at it through a different lens. rendering the subject-object conflation redundant, so to speak. So in most instances of 16th century literature, domesticity figures as the category, the mediating category between the subject's gaze and the object. You know, between the subject and the object is this category called domesticity. We notice this happening in literatures as diverse as Telugu, Malayalam, Kannada, and Odia. So this development has to be appreciated as a structural shift in consciousness, rather than as a conscious attempt by men and women who produced these literatures to invoke a distinct category for looking at the object. So what alienation actually brought into effect is too early to say, for not only have historians begun to take cognizance of it in recent times, but the progress made to that effect is fairly marginal, I should say. Even so, it is not hard to reflect upon its dynamics. So the cognitive separation of the subject and the object made it possible for the subject to approach the object with an element of alterity, with an element of otherness that was absolute in character. This was at the same time not a tabula rasa approach to the object, but mediated by categories that framed the gaze in distinct ways. The mediating category here is a family, domesticity, which is to say the household and the kinship relations that we find there. In the Lakshmi Purana, domestic life is the reified ideal. You get me? It is the reified ideal forming the category through which Balarama Das's gaze falls on the question of caste discrimination. We see this from the very beginning of the text. Look at the first two lines. Namaste Kamala Mago Sagara Dulani. Namaste Namaste Lakshmi Vishnunka Gharani. Namaste Kamala Mai Ati Dayavati. The mother, Ma, appears in the first line. Namaste Kamala Ma. It's an affectionate way of addressing Magu. I believe that Gangadhar Mehar endorsed this mode of addressing a revered woman. He does the same in Tapaswini Naiki. Kiye gotu jyotirmai shuddha suprabesha indra neela dyuti jita manohara kesha. And Balaramadasa calls Lakshmi Sagara Dulhani. Dulhani is the girl that a father offers as a bride. So in the next line, she is Vishnunka Gharani, Vishnu's homemaker. This approach to human relations continues throughout the text. When we look at Kavya texts from earlier centuries, we notice that this mode of representation only figures in the text at various places. Now, that is from about the mid 15th century onwards, it is coming to the center stage. Okay. For those among you who might be interested in this line of thinking, I suggest this. Please try this exercise. Pick up a copy of the Lakshmi Purana and count the number of times that the words such as Ma, Mai, Bhai, Stri, Putra, Nandana, and so on, words such as these are used in the text. Count the number of times these words occur in the text. You will be amazed by the frequency of these words. This is not happening because Balarama Dasa is deploying this as a method, as a mode of articulation, as a piece of craft. Not at all. Not at all. Because we come across pretty much the same thing in 16th century works of literature in Kannada, in Telugu, in Malayalam. We notice that the family becomes a mediating principle between the subject and the object. In literatures of most Indian languages, and this is pointing to a deep shift in the structure of imagination itself. So the Jagannatha temple is represented as the residence of Jagannatha, Balarama, and Lakshmi. We don't get the sense that Balarama Dasa is actually describing a temple. We actually get the sense that he is describing a family. Its layout is described with great attention to mundane details, which doesn't create the impression that it's a temple at all. We get a picture of the kitchen in Lakshmi's instructions to the vampires. Ashta betala tume emanta karibo pratame rasoi shale jayega hasibo. साटीय पाउटी भोग भुंजिबो जेताई तेरा पाटी व्यंजन खाइब हस होई साग मुग मधुरुचि तिक्त कांजिराई अम्बिल खाइब खंड शक्कर मिसाई अमृत मनो ही मान भोजन करिब हांडी मान नहीं एकोटारे छाड़ब. So the description of Lakshmi preparing the food, preparing the food for the brothers is even more vivid in its details. It's almost a text that borders on the realistic. Prathame randile mai bagala janma muggo madhuruchi khiri nanadi vyanjana ambila sakkara kalle kadalira bhaja ati jatne kalle mai tiyana je manja. साटीए पाउटी से रंधन कले जाई बगड़ भात महिमा कलना नना जाए दूध पुली कले माए घृत पुली कले अति जतन रे माए सर पुली कले जिते द्रव्य रांधि ब्राह्मण करुची बड़ीर मुहूर कले पकड़ साहस्र अटिका रांधि द्रव्य सजाड़े जे जहा स्थान जत्ने रखाण दे कर्पूर छेना शक्कर मरीच गोलाई साटी माउती पण रखिले कि सारे गंगा बण पैडा संगते छेना पण अदा मिसी करी जे नबा तो खंड छेना आ लक्ष्मीकर पाक गुण के कही पारिब क्षण मध्य रे क्षण को मध्य रे माए सजाड़िले सर्व सबु थिरो खंडिए खंडिए रखिथिला भोजन शेष को पड़ा पिटाए रखिला. Unlike any literary texts produced before the 16th century, the household that Balarama Dasa brings to us consists of a host of objects that the old connoisseurs of literature might have spurned upon as crude, as gramya. So what was once gramya is now at the heart of poetry. We hear of a bed of rope, we hear of smoke stains, bamboo stick, plantain leaves, pots made of brass, and many such things, vegetables, milk products and sugar lumps, scented water for bathing, water bowl, towel, and even sieve and the broom, jhadu. So the description that the poet provides is rich, it is exceptionally rich, and it has a keen sense of observation and eye for detail. So in the scene where Lakshmi is instructing the seafarer's wife on how to perform the Lakshmi Puja, we find an elaborate description of the ritual. It's as if one is reading an Agama text that describes how a set of religious ceremonies are to be performed. So this is in striking contrast to the poetically embellished and outlandish pictures that we find in literature from earlier times. So David Shulman, in his study of 16th century literary texts from southern India, has argued persuasively that a strong sense of nature as an observable category, as an observable entity, appears for the first time in South Asia in the 16th century. Nature as an observable category. So nature now figures as something that is separated from humankind and functioning in a manner that is independent of humankind, which is to say, nature is now functioning with its own logic. There is much in the literatures of 16th century and after to extend this aspect of alienation to affairs of the human world as well. It is not hard to see the domesticity with all its finer pragmatic details in the reified template which animates Balarama Dasa's imagination. So the poet's approach to the world is through this template or this lens, as it were, which functions as the mediating factor to his gaze. So domesticity is the unconscious category from which Balarama Dasa's assessment of the world gains its substance. So prima facie, the Lakshmi Purana is a critique of caste, but unlike the older frame of mind where the subject is in some senses looking at itself, because the object and the categories through which the object is approached are one and the same, we don't find caste consciousness looking at caste consciousness. It is an individual located within the family who is looking at caste, because something is happening to the family. The family, the household, kinship, or whatever one wants to call it, is a mediating factor between the individual and the caste structure. So it need not be caste all the time. In this text, it is caste, but in other works of the 16th century, it is sometimes love, it is sometimes valor, it is sometimes bhakti. In all these cases, the individual is looking at the object through the family. There is a separation between the subject and the object, and this separation is mediated by the idea of domesticity. And this is what I call alienation. So a harmonious domestic life is the acceptable normal, in this reified imagination. So an examination or a representation of the world has to go through this test of the normalcy of quotidian existence. So herein lies the breach between the subject and the object, which given the mediation of domesticity as a category, cannot collude into each other. The collusion is not possible because there is a mediating factor in between. So the subject is now distanced from the world and capable of clearly structured gaze at the other. The subject can now look at the other in a very clear way, even when the category which provides for this alienated gaze is owing to reification and not consciously articulated. So caste prejudice appears in Lakshmi Purana as a factor that disturbs and disrupts the normalcy of domestic life. Note that caste discrimination and not caste identity is the undesirable factor here. Caste identity is not the undesirable factor, it's caste discrimination which is undesirable. So in what ways do these prejudices affect the reified normal? Can in retrospect be seen as the text's chief concern. And an analysis of this concern brings us to the conclusion that it has an ontology premised upon the historical alienation of the subject from the object, an alterity which made the assertion of caste identities a rebellious political act. Let me stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for going beyond this simplistic frame of this is quite brilliant, to say the least, to bring about a structuralist perspective on the mediating variable of family, where from the earlier individual as subject and outside world as object, which are conflated in earlier times, is mediated in the site of family. But how did this, initiate this discussion now? How did this site change with this structural change of bringing in this mediating variable, which became reified as well? Therefore, how did the coming of this, how did this development of ontology of alienation of subject and object through the reified of category of family change the object itself or change the mediating category as such? And in what way these reifications of family affect or change the social fabric, which we could we could look at as an object. Also, the Vice Chancellor has a question, you can directly take these questions. But there is also another questions regarding from a student. May I just sum up some of the questions that has come up? One is very trivial question, or it cannot be trivial. So where did Subhadra go when Balaram and Jagannatha went out? The other questions is, even though Lakshmi Purana has a discursive text challenge the way society defines identities, which you obviously made the problematic, here there is a questions regarding this
from this Marxist angle, the way society defines identity and rewards virtues, as has been described in Lakshmi Purana. At the same time, there are issues of purity and pollution associated with rituals. But the question, answer could be any ritualization process involved the creation of these purities and pollution norms. But you could address these questions about Lakshmi Purana as a discursive text. At the same time, issues of purity and pollution associated with the observance of the rituals by female folk. And then Vice Chancellor, Honorable Vice Chancellor asked a question which I could not record. Sir can also come in and ask questions and also carry forward the discussion now. But it's very important not to have the Saussurean or the structuralist perspective about subject-object dichotomy. But is it not a fact that, for example, in Meghadutam, how did the cloud being described? Is there no difference between subject-object dichotomy in classical Kavya literature of 5th century AD? Can you please throw light on this? May I request also the Honorable Vice Chancellor to also carry forward the discussion now.
Thank you, Dr. Mishra. I think you should be carrying the discussion further, but just a small intervention. Dr. Manudevan, I thoroughly enjoyed your talk. When Dr. Mishra described you as a polyglot, I was wondering, but you thoroughly justified that description. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Could you throw some light on the social conditions of the so-called Chandala caste? Any change in their conditions which made the other caste, particularly the elite, to recognize their change in condition and ask for their incorporation into the ritual or the other cultural aspects of the times? That's one. Second, can you think of Purana or Puranic Zara as one Zara which also consists of the oppositional, which includes the oppositional in the narrative? Can you think of that Zara in a very baggy way, where the establishment as well as the anti-establishment stand get incorporated in that one particular Zara as against those Zaras which are more monochromatic? Maybe you could try on that. Thank you.
Thank you for those comments, Dr. Mishra and Dr. Nagaraju. The question that you asked on the social conditions of the Chandala caste, I think, is very difficult to answer, because that we have on hand is fairly limited, and so far as I can tell, we do not have any research on this. Of course, we do have interesting research for an earlier period by Vivekananda Jha and others. Jha, in fact, has a whole monograph on the Chandalas in the early historical and early medieval period. But by the time we come to the 16th century, the references in the sources to the Chandalas gradually begin to fade away, and we do not have too many occurrences of this category. So it is also becoming very difficult to identify a concrete group in society whom we can identify as Chandalas. So these are the difficulties due to which it may be very difficult to tell what the social conditions of the Chandalas were in the 16th century. Coming to Dr. Mishra's question on how was things different in the Meghadutta, for example. I think in the Meghadutta, or in the text before the time of Bharati, I was specifically referring to Kiratarjuniya and the changes that it affected in the literary imagination. We do not find this kind of a conflation between the subject and the object before the 5th century. You don't have it in the Ramayana, you don't have it in the texts of Kalidasa, you don't have it in Ashvaghosha. So there you have a fairly different order of things, where the subject and the object have their own distinct positions. So the change that I was suggesting is something that begins to emerge
from about the later half of the 5th century, visibly the Kiratarjuna. And from there, for almost 1,000 years, we have that kind of an imagination. We do not really know why this is happening, but one thing that we know very clearly is that this is also the period when the mode of production is largely centering on land. So before the 4th century, land is of course important, but there is in some senses labor figuring much more prominently than land itself as a mode of production. That begins to change from the 4th, 5th, 6th century onwards due to a number of historical processes. R.S. Sharma would call it feudalism. More recent historians would actually refrain from using that expression. But one thing is certainly there for all of us to see. Land is appearing on the center stage of production in this period. And by the time we come to Lakshmi Purana, the 16th century, land is of course important, but it is gradually getting supplanted by money. Money is becoming the much more decisive factor as far as production is concerned. So these changes between the advent of a more land-centered mode of production and a more money-centered mode of production, which is of course not capitalism. Let's not mistake this to be capitalism, but it's more gravitating towards monetization. So the two of them are likely to create very different forms of reified imagination. And that is precisely what we see in the difference between the Kiratarjuna on the one hand and the Balaramadasa's Lakshmi Purana on the other. In fact, this presentation today is part of a larger project. You know, it's a continuation of the work that I did on the Kiratarjuna, tracing certain important cognitive shifts in imagination that happens in Kavya literature in our times. Now let me look at a few questions that I have in the comment box. There is one question which is, Balaramadasa's Lakshmi Purana is a feminist text primarily because it shows a female goddess using her personal power to challenge the way society defines identity. I think that is the argument that is being made throughout, whether by Satyaprakash Mahanti or by others who have been writing about it. And that's not a very comfortable argument, I would say, because ideally speaking, I would like that agency to be with the woman herself and not with the goddess. Okay, and Lakshmi herself instructs the women. It's a fairly extensive instruction where she asks women to be as docile as she can. So the agency, shifting the agency, the feminist agency from the woman to a goddess doesn't make for a feminist text. So if that is retained in the woman herself, I would have loved to call this a feminist text. So in that sense, I beg to disagree with that position. What other questions do you have? There is a question called where was Subhadra? I'm sorry, Balaramadasa does not provide us with an answer. He doesn't tell us anything about what happens to Subhadra. Casteism and untouchability now also prevails in Odisha, particularly in rural areas. So what is the role of Lakshmi Purana to change the minds of illiterate people, particularly in rural areas in Odisha? As I mentioned, the Lakshmi Purana performed a very important ritual function, but I think I also stated that there is a pedagogic function which the text had. And as far as this function is concerned, it must have been a failure. I don't think that the pedagogic function which the text sought to serve had any real life implications, because we don't see the vanishing away of caste system after the coming of this text. So it had an important presence in the ritual life of the region, but that might not have led to far reaching changes in the structure, in the caste structure or in gender relations. And I, for one, do not really believe that a text can always lead to some kind of a large scale social transformation. That has to happen through a large number of economic and political processes. You know, who owns the land? What is the form of succession that you have in the family? All these are questions which are important important questions which determine the structure, the caste structure or gender relations in a society. So just because we have a text which challenges some of these premises, there is no need for us to believe that the text brought about far-reaching changes in the real-life conditions of women. Because as far as the oldest ethnographic documents that we have from Odisha is concerned, late 18th, early 19th century, we do see that the conditions were quite miserable. They were quite miserable. And the conditions might have been made more miserable because of the British intervention, because 19th century is also an age of famine. The famine of 1866, I believe, wiped away about a third of the population of Odisha. So that might have even more aggravated the existing situation. But even so, I believe that by the late 18th century itself, you have a situation where we do not get a sense that this particular text, or any text for that matter, brought about far-reaching changes in the actual conditions of life. That depends on the mode of production, that depends on access to resources, that it depends on the structure of the economy at large, and to a certain extent, the political structure as well. Although I don't really believe in political determinism, but politics is also an important factor there.
Sir, one little doubt. If this mediating structure of family doesn't allow the individual and the caste to collude, how did it change the mediating structure? As and when the priestly gaze becomes more rigid, more orthodox. Hello.
Yeah. So I was saying that, in fact, the situation becomes a little more rigid in later times, particularly in the 17th and 18th century, because that is the period when some of the royal positions that you have, and which I mentioned, whether it is Patra, yes, whether it is Mahanti, whether it is Kuntia, these are becoming inherited caste identities. That is not there in the 14th or 15th or 16th century. They are offices under the state. And by the time you are in the 17th or 18th century, Kuntia is actually a caste. Patra is a caste. Mahapatra is a caste. So that transformation is also happening simultaneously. So you're right that in some senses, the social structure is becoming a little more rigid than it is in the 14th or 13th century. But the other point is that there is also a favor. There are also people who want that to happen. Balarama Das himself included. Because as I said, his critique is not against the caste structure. His critique is against caste discrimination. He wants to retain the identity, but he wants others to respect that identity. He wants others to treat that identity with dignity. So he is not calling for an abolition of caste, the caste system per se. He wants only to bring an end to the discrimination that is embedded within this system. So it is becoming quite rigid in later times. But only in the 19th century do we find that the mediating structure is also becoming multiple. It's not the family alone anymore. You know, in some texts, the individual itself can become a mediating principle. Yes. The best example would be the text that I mentioned. You know, that is Gangadhar Mehr's text. It begins with this fascinating line, and I don't think there is any piece of poetry that begins with this question: "Who are you? Kiye gotu jyotirmayi? Who are you?" You know. So there, the kind of individualization that you see there is more or less absolute. More or less absolute. And the mediating factor can also be very diverse. Sometimes when you come to the later part of the 19th century or early 20th century, nationalism can be a mediating factor. Patriotism itself can be a mediating factor. You don't find these multiple mediating factors in the 16th century. Of course, you don't find it in earlier times, but you at least have something in the 16th century, which I have identified as domesticity. But it is making things a little more rigid. Because we must also realize that this was the time when there is a greater preference in economic terms, there is a greater preference for smallholds. You know, so this practice of having extensive landed property is gradually losing its favor, and more people are trying to obtain a plot of land, which is a smallhold. And if it is a smallhold, the preference should ideally be for commercial crops, for cash crops, because otherwise having a smallhold, if you are cultivating grain on a smallhold, it may not be a viable economic alternative. So there is also a growing preference for smallhold, and simultaneously there is a growing preference for cash crop economy as well. So that has some implications on the manner in which you understand your household, you understand your family, you understand kinship ties, etc., etc. Because the question of succession, which you have from very early times, is now getting gradually generalized. It's becoming a generalized question. So that also, I think, is a context in which these kind of texts are being produced. But I think much more research needs to be done before stating these tentative hypotheses as firm conclusions. But one thing is sure, there is alienation by the 16th century.
Yes. There are a lot more from my side, but you know, the others would also ask questions. Is there any questions from the participant? They can come live and ask directly questions to the speaker. So how do you look at these vernacularizations in Odisha vis-a-vis Karnada? And also the difference
between... Well, in Kannada, it has a little more longer history, I guess, you know, because some of the earliest written fragments in Kannada dates back to the 5th and 6th century. These are the inscriptions. And the oldest literary text is already there in the 9th century. You have the Kaviraja marker. So Kannada, and to a certain extent Telugu as well, has a history of vernacularization that goes back to the 9th and 10th century in literary terms, and to the 5th and 6th century in epigraphical terms. But that may not be happening in Eastern India, I guess. And of course, there is this classic quarrel between the four languages on identifying, you know, or associating themselves with Maithili. You know, Maithili itself, then there is Bengali, there is Assami, and there is Odia itself. So all four languages tracing their roots back to the Charyapadas and other such Apabhramsha texts. Mm. So that quarrel is also very much there. But we also need to reflect upon the manner in which writing, you know, the popularity of writing, literacy itself, might have enabled these languages to develop on different lines. And this is most obviously seen in the script that you have, the difference in script between Bengali and Odia. Bengali is the elongated script, the kind of script that you have in the north, you know, be it Siddhamatrika or what other texts, the text that Sharada and so on. So it's not the same text, but it's the longer kind of text. But whereas when you come to Odia, you have the round text, the kind of text that you have in the script that you have in Tamil or Malayalam or Odi or Kannada or Telugu, you have the round text. Why is this the case? This is the case because you are using palm leaf as a means. You are writing on palm leaf. And when you're writing on palm leaf, it is very difficult to have strokes, straight lines, you know, whether it's vertical line or horizontal line, because the palm leaf tends to break away. You know, it breaks into two pieces. Whereas in North India, that is not the case. In North India, you are writing on certain other materials. Of course, paper is already there by this time. And even before that, you were using birch leaf. And it's not a leaf, it's actually a bark, the bark of the birch plant, burja. And there you are actually painting. You have a brush and you actually write with this brush. This brush is made of the hair of a camel's tail. And you immerse that and you write it the way you write Chinese. So there you cannot have round alphabets because since you're writing with a brush, the ink tends to spill over, you know. So that is that it spreads in certain fashion. So that is one reason why there is a very significant difference in the shape of characters in the scripts of the south and the north. And you see that divide between Bengali and Odia. In Bengali, the script is very different because apparently in Bengali, a palm leaf was not widely used, or it was not used at all, perhaps, correct me if I'm wrong. But in Odia, palm leaf is the most important means of writing. So the manner in which scripts evolved also might have facilitated the manner in which language itself might have evolved. And Sheldon Pollock, I don't think sheds much light on this question. Of course, he writes about script. He, in fact, coins an expression called script mercantilism. You know, he says that we had in South Asia a whole phase of script mercantilism. That might be, of course, true. But script has a much greater role in articulating the contours of language itself. And if there is a very clear distinction between Bengali and Odia today, in terms of language itself, I think part of the reason is also that the script evolved differently because the medium were very different.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. And, you know, this would obviously prompt all of us to think differently. I am extremely thankful to you and to the Honorable Vice Chancellor, other participant who came and listened to your talk. We'll continue to collaborate. I'm extremely thankful to you for your talk. Thank you so much. Now I if Dr. Pathy is around, can I request you to give a formal vote of thanks? Otherwise, let this be treated as a formal thanks, and then let me request Professor Nagaraju to announce formal closure of the meeting.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mano Devadevan. I think the university will be in touch with you for any future endeavors in this direction. Thank you, and the program comes to a close.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Namaskar to all. Namaskar.
Thank you. Thank you.
Namaskar, sir.
Thank you.
Namaskar, sir.